ॐ भूर्भुवः स्वः तत्सवितुर्वरेण्यं भर्गो देवस्य धीमहि धियो यो नः प्रचोदयात्। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। नमस्कार माई डियर फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज ए वेरी इम्पोर्टेंट वीडियो। इन दिस वीडियो आई एम giving an interview with Annamalai Swami. The following is transcribed from a November 1989 videotaped interview with Annamalai Swami. J. Jayaraman was the interviewer and James Hartel the videographer. Some of this interview is featured in the Guru Ramana His Living Presence video production. Coming to Bhagwan, Annamalai Swami says, I came from Tanda Guruchi, where I had a stall to distribute water to the needy. One day somebody showed me the book Nan Yaar, Who Am I? I saw Bhagwan's picture and was instantly captivated. I hastened to Thiruvannamalai the very same day, which happened to be a full moon day. When I arrived at Thiruvannamalai, I chanced to meet Seshadri Swami near the Retai Pillayar Koil, close to the big temple, and received his blessings. I then went to Sri Bhagwan. When I came to the ashram, there was just a shade over the mother's shrine and Bhagwan was seated there. I also saw Gopal Rao, who was building the old hall. Before coming to Thiruvannamalai, I had a dream in which Bhagwan was coming down the hill. I went up to him and washed his feet with water. On drinking that water, I felt speechless and senseless. When I came here, Bhagwan was coming from the hill, but nothing else happened like in the dream. I had read a little before coming here. However, it is true that Bhagwan literally taught me how to read and write. When I asked Bhagwan what bondage and liberation meant, Murugunar was astonished that I did not even know the fundamentals of Advaitic teachings. Bhagwan only laughed in reply. In the course of my work, I once overheard Murugunar sing a line from Tamil verse, which means, even fools have become extremely wise by coming to Bhagwan. I am sure that Murugunar was referring to me when he sang this song. Major Chadwick. When Chadwick arrived in Thiruvannamalai, he mistook me for Bhagwan and prostrated before me. I then took him to Bhagwan. Also, I was asked to vacate the room I had been occupying at the time in favor of Chadwick. Chadwick did not like this and said that if I vacated, he would not stay at the ashram. It was then agreed that the two of us would share the room. This is how I became very friendly with Chadwick. He appreciated my hard work and sincerity. I even used to learn a little bit of English from Chadwick. Chadwick gave me an umbrella, shaded eye glasses and sandals to use when I was supervising or working in the hot sun. Once when Bhagwan came by, I tried to remove all three. Then Bhagwan came near me and chided me, saying, If you behave like this on seeing me, I will never come near you. The irony is that some others in the ashram used to scoff at me for wearing these in Bhagwan's presence. I was in a dilemma because it was Bhagwan who insisted that I behave normally or he would not come near me. If you got up from your seat when Bhagwan passed by, he would not be happy and would say, So you are showing off your bhakti. Why not behave normally even when I come? Construction work. I knew nothing about masonry work before coming here. Although my father was proficient in masonry, sculpture, astrology and other fine arts, I knew none of these when I came to Bhagwan. Bhagwan taught me everything. One day, Thanammapatti asked Bhagwan how I could apply my mind to supervise all the construction work that was going on and still be devoted to Bhagwan. Bhagwan laughed and remarked that I would have been an engineer in my previous birth. It was in very subtle ways that Bhagwan extracted work from the devotees. During my early days with Bhagwan, he once told me, Go and see what the mason is doing. So I went there, asked him what he was doing and conveyed the reply to Bhagwan. After some time, Bhagwan again asked me to go and see what the mason was doing. I complied. The mason was a little annoyed but made the same reply. When Bhagwan asked me to go and see what the mason was doing for the third time, the mason thought that Bhagwan was mad as he was just asking him the same question again and again. I now asked Bhagwan why he kept repeating the same question. That is when he came out with his intentions and said, Someone can attend to the work here. You go and supervise that work. I reflected that Bhagwan could have told me this in the first instance itself, or just ordered me to go and do it. But that was not Bhagwan's way. He was very subtle, shy, and very gentle. Bhagwan would indicate with only a few words or signs. Bhagwan used to say, This whole place is going to be very active with many buildings. Some of his comments were hard to believe because no indication of such things was found then. When the storeroom was being built, Bhagwan wanted me to make an image of Arunachala in cement. I honestly felt that I was overworked, not getting enough rest. Also, I was feeling a little dejected. A little later, Bhagwan came back and said, I thought I could make that request, but if that is difficult for you, don't bother with it. I felt badly about the thoughts I had entertained and resolved that in the future I would definitely undertake and fulfill any of Bhagwan's requests. Even if that should mean sacrificing my body, it was a solemn pledge I made to myself. Bhagwan was very particular about doing things meticulously and perfectly. On all cupboards and other furniture, the name Sri Ramanasramam Trivanamalai had to be written very neatly, just like printed letters. Bhagwan insisted that I should draw the image of Arunachala on the wall of the ashram store. When it did not come out properly, Bhagwan came and instructed me. However, it did not come out the second time as well. भगवान वंस अगेन गेव मी ए फ्यू हिंट्स एंड आई मैनेज्ड टू गेट इट राइट द थर्ड टाइम एंड इट कैन बी सीन एट द स्टोर एंट्रेंस इवन टुडे. द थ्री डाइमेंशनल एस्पेक्ट इज ऑल्सो विजिबल ऑन अकाउंट ऑफ द सीमेंट बींग प्लास्टर्ड अकॉर्डिंगली. द सेम थिंग हैपन्ड विद द आर्क ऑफ द आश्रम एंट्रेंस. भगवान वुड एनकरेज मी टू टेक अप सच वर्क एंड व्हेनेवर आई हैड डिफिकल्टी भगवान वुड कम गिव हिंट्स एंड एनकरेज मी टू डू इट परफेक्टली. वन डे आई वॉज फीलिंग टायर्ड एंड वॉज रेक्लाइनिंग अगेंस्ट ए वॉल. भगवान केम अप टू मी एंड सेड आई एम अफ्रेड टू इवन लुक एट यू. I asked him why that should be so. He said if I would just look in one direction, you would construct a structure there. This was of course in jest, but it also meant that I could understand Bhagwan's subtle instructions and follow them meticulously. This was great appreciation showered upon me by Sri Bhagwan. Once I was about to construct some steps when Bhagwan came and hit me three times. I had been asked to repair some dilapidated steps behind the dining hall. In those days money and materials were scarce. I asked Rama Swami Pillai to get three or four measures of cement. Now in Tamil Nadu the word paddy stands for both measure as well as for steps. Bhagwan asked me how many padis, meaning how many steps I was constructing. I thought he wanted to know how many measures of cement I was ordering. Bhagwan gave me a playful slap and said, I am asking about one padi and you are answering about another. On another occasion, I was building some steps near the water tap. Bhagwan was standing there and giving me instructions. I got up. I banged my head hard against the tap. Bhagwan asked Madhava Swami to bring jambak, medicinal ointment, and personally massaged my head for a long time. Though I had pain in my head, I kept reminding myself of Bhagwan's teaching, which was to give up the I am the body idea. I also thanked the tap for giving me this opportunity to receive a massage from the golden hands of Sri Bhagwan. In the earlier days, Madhava Swami, Ranga Swami and I used to massage the soles of Bhagwan's feet with oil and put our heads against his feet to receive his grace after completing the massage. Bhagwan used to pretend to be asleep when we did this. However, when large crowds started coming to the ashram regularly, we had to stop this practice of ours. When the dining hall was being built, Bhagwan used to dig the earth with a huge gadda pair, crowbar and santhamma used to mix mortar with water. I was interested with the mason's work. While we worked on the construction, Thinamma and Subbulakshmi Amma used to do the cooking nearby. As I was not a Brahmin, the woman used a large white cloth as a partition between them and us. Bhagwan told them, why are you doing this? It's only our Anamalai Swami. Why should you segregate him like this? Chinna Swami on hearing this said, Bhagwan says our Anamalai, so he has become a Ichha Brahmin, that is a Brahmin by the wish of Sri Bhagwan. Disturbing ants. One day after lunch we noticed lots of ants in the old hall disturbing the devotees. Bhagwan asked me to inspect the area and do the needful. when I went and lifted a stone millions of ants rushed out. I was jumping all over in order to avoid crushing them. When Bhagwan asked me what I was doing, I explained that it would be jiva hinsa to kill hundreds and thousands of ants by stepping upon them or by closing the opening through which they came out. He said, "You are not doing it for yourself. It is for the sake of others." He then quoted from chapter 13 of Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna says that even killing is permitted if it is for the benefit of the world. Upon hearing this, I cleared the area of ants, sealed the entrance and cemented it. In the days when I still used to live in the ashram, I once told Bhagwan that I did not even desire moksha, but I just wanted to be saved from the attractions of women. I was wondering what reply Bhagwan would give. He said that it was freedom from this desire that all great people had sought and suffered for, fleeing to Polur. Bhagwan always taught Jnana Marga, yet when he went out, no one ever talked about Jnana Marga or even Bhakti Marga. And since at that time I felt that whatever bhakti I had evaporated, I was feeling that Bhagwan did not want me to stay there. I walked without any food for 2 days and was weak and exhausted by the time I reached Polur. I begged at Nair Mangalam's place and many other places with no luck. None wished to give me alms. In fact, one person wondered why I had to leave a holy place like Tiruvannamalai and wander elsewhere. All these events disgraced me. I had heard that if one stood chest deep in water, it would aid in withstanding hunger. I did that in a tank just outside Polur for a while before leaving for the Samadhi of Vithoba in Polur. In the afternoon on the third day, a lady took pity at my plight and offered me 2 glassful full of thin gruel. This helped me to regain some of my strength. I then plucked a little flower in order to toss it up to divine if I should go back to the ashram or leave Bhagwan permanently and go out as a wandering mendicant. The flower tossed up indicated that I should go back to Bhagwan, and I began walking back promptly. That's when the owner of a small roadside hotel invited me in and fed me sumptuously with great reverence. Besides, he also gave me 2 rupees for my travel expense. I took this as a good omen and vindication of my decision to return to Bhagwan. I boarded the train to Tiruvannamalai without a ticket. However, while the ticket examiner checked all other passengers, he totally ignored me. Similarly, when I got down at Tiruvannamalai, the station master, who usually checks all the tickets, let me through, saying that he had already checked my ticket. I went straight to Bhagwan and narrated all that had happened. Bhagwan graciously said, "How could you go away? You have so much work to do here, and unless that is finished, how could you go?" I was standing near Bhagwan and he gave me a steady look of grace. I felt that Bhagwan was quoting the song from the supplement to the 40 verses, which means, when you have the association of great men, there is the need for following the usual injunctions expected of a seeker, like going on a yatra, remaining in mauna, etc. This song came to my mind, though Bhagwan had not uttered a word. That gave me great confidence, and I declared in the presence of Bhagwan that I would stay put and do whatever Bhagwan asked of me. Bhagwan smiled at me and gave me another look of grace. There are many instances when Bhagwan showered grace by his look. On seeing this, Shivalinga tried to my left arm. Shivalinga tied to my left arm. Bhagwan repeatedly said, "You have the Lord tied to your hand. What more do you want?" It was my father who had this linga tied to my arm. The Tamil religious calendar says that upon rising every morning, one should look at the sun in one's right hand and at a linga in the left. As I was interested in following this injunction, it was suggested that I could have a linga tattooed on my hand. But my father preferred a linga itself to be tied to my left hand. Bhagwan used to repeatedly tell me, "God is in your own hands. What shortcomings can you face in your life?" Animals. Bhagwan was extraordinarily kept towards birds, squirrels, cows, dogs, and peacocks. In fact, he showed visible partiality towards animals over humans. Once a big doe fell down on being attacked by a vulture. Bhagwan personally attended to the bird and treated it with jambak and other oils. He massaged its head and kept the doe for the whole day. The next day, when he asked me to bring the doe to him, the bird had by then recovered so much that it flew off. I was present when the crow, towards which Bhagwan showed extraordinary kindness, died in his hands. So also Jackie the dog and Wally the deer. When the samadhi was being built for Wally, I was very thin and could easily go inside the tiny dome to do the plastering work. Bhagwan used to stand outside and hand me chuna and other material and helped me complete the samadhi. The crow was very fortunate to die in his hands. Bhagwan was particularly interested in rituals for the samadhis of the birds and animals and wanted special pujas to be done for such samadhis with offerings of milk, etc. Many people used to witness this with awe and wonder. Once, as Bhagwan was descending the steps near the Wally deer's samadhi, he saw a dog chasing a squirrel. Bhagwan tried to prevent the dog from harming the squirrel by interposing his stick in between them. In the process, he stumbled and fell down the steps, suffering bruises all over his body. Tincture was applied all over, which causes a burning sensation. Plaster was applied on all the wounds, and there are even photographs of Bhagwan with plaster all over his body. Bhagwan underwent such suffering even for animals. We all have witnessed these phases in Bhagwan's life. Moving to Pallakottu. I moved to Pallakottu during the time when the dining hall was being built under my supervision. One day, Yogi Ramaya was accompanying Bhagwan and told him that I had become very weak from so much hard work and that I should be released from this strain. Bhagwan also said, "Yes, yes, he should be given freedom." Resolving to put an end to the tension and mental suffering, I went up the hill to meet Bhagwan and requested permission to stay in Pallakottu. Bhagwan said, "Yes, yes, that's good for you," and he repeated it thrice. A little later, I went into the bathroom when Bhagwan was being given an oil bath. Madhava Swami, his attendant, remarked that many sadhus are known to take ganja, hemp, and asked him how one would feel on consuming ganja. Bhagwan then suddenly got up and holding me by shoulder said, "It will only be like this." I felt such a great joy when he held me that I handed over the keys of my room to Bhagwan immediately and left for Palakottu. When I left the ashram, I had no thoughts about where I would stay or what I would do for food. Munangala Venkataramaya gave me shelter at Palakottu and I cooked my own food. Bhagwan used to occasionally inquire about my cooking and made encouraging comments. For instance, if I told him that I made just one sambar, he would say, "Oh, one sambar, that's very good." Once when I had more than one eatable to offer Bhagwan, he remarked, "Just like Annamalai, Annamaliar has Madhavapadi." Bhagwan was comparing his receiving food at the ashram as well as at other places to the idol of Annamalai in the Arunachaleswara temple, which stops at each mandap and is offered food. Bhagwan has come to this place and even had some food cooked by me. Whenever I was engaged in construction work at the ashram or Palakottu, Bhagwan would inspect my work and instruct me. Once Bhagwan visited me when I was removing the scaffolding from my house. As I could not complete the construction for want of money, when I told Bhagwan the reason, he said, "Oh, so you have to remove this scaffolding for the sake of money," and went away. That same evening, a lady came from Rama Swami, stayed here for a month and donated ₹100. This house was completed with that money, along with the help from Vaikunathwa Sagar. I shall tell you the story of how this house was designed. My friend Arumugam and I were planning to build a small thatched shed for me to live in. Bhagwan heard our discussions from afar and inquired about our plans from Arumugam. He then asked many leading questions relating to the design of the house. "Will you use mortar, lime, bricks, etc.?" he asked. "Will the house give an upper floor? Will there be a mortared top, etc.?" Thus, without saying so explicitly, Bhagwan conveyed to Arumugam the design he had in mind for my house. Arumugam settled for that very plan and bought 4,000 bricks the next day, along with the lime making equipment for small lime factory. This look of Bhagwan made Arumugam a big contractor years later. "Do not move out," one day he told me very clearly and sternly. "Don't move out anywhere. Stay put here and don't move to the next house or even the next room." After moving to Palakottu, I used to come to Bhagwan every day at around 8 at night. After dinner, which was served at 7:30 and stayed till about 9 o'clock. One night, I saw Bhagwan completely enclosed in a piece of cloth except for the nose. I used to converse freely with Bhagwan like a son with his father. I asked him, "Does this mean that you do not like to meet me here, or is it that you don't want me to come to the ashram at all?" Bhagwan remained silent. At about 9 o'clock, I left the hall. I was nearing the garden thinking about Bhagwan's directive to me to stay put at Palakottu when I heard him call me. He beckoned me to him and said in a very strong and stern voice, "He who, despite the right spiritual maturity, thinks that he is different from the Lord will reach the same lower state as does a non-believer. I felt that Bhagwan was telling me not to move out of Parlakotu, not even to visit the ashram. I have never left Parlakotu since, said O Bhagwan. Once there were films being shown at the ashram, including one on Bhagwan. I wanted to see the film. When I arrived and prostrated before Bhagwan, he said in a stern voice, "So you have come to see the shadow of Bhagwan. This means that you no longer have the real Bhagwan in you and have hence come to see this shadow Bhagwan." This touched me very deeply. One day after this incident, I went up the hill wanting to meet Bhagwan when he returned from his walk. He again looked at me sternly and said, "Why have you come to see me? You have happiness, you have happiness." I could not understand these his words then, but after a lot of reflection, I realized that when one is away from society, one has peace, and that Bhagwan wanted me to avoid the entire society. This is how I interpreted his words. Bhagwan also said, "Ananda is not what you get from somewhere else. If you follow somebody else's path, it will only lead you to destruction. You have to follow your own self, go within. That alone will lead you to Ananda." So I interpreted it to mean that I should be alone. So this was the intent of the interview. So thank you, my dear friends, for listening this interview of Anamalai Swami. Thank you. Namaste. Please like, comment and share the video and subscribe the channel. Thanks a lot, my dear friends. Namaskar.